let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your love for us and for the wonderful provision that you've given us in this building, and for your work in our hearts, Lord, and in our lives, for our families and friends. Lord, we just thank you for all that you've given us, and we just pray that you would help us to be grateful this morning. We are thankful for your love, for your mercy, for your grace. Lord, your mercies are new every morning. We need that. Lord, thank you for bringing us through the dark times, the hard times. Thank you for bringing us here to church today. And I just pray that you would bless our time here. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Besides my family, I'm going to start out that way this week. Besides my family, whom I love very much, my wife, my children, my mother, other sundry sisters and brothers and father and all those people, there are some things I really, really like. I love. One thing I love is I love reading classic science fiction. So that would be science fiction before 1970. If you have any old science fiction books, you want to give them to me to read, I'd love to read them. And I also love fixing things. I love fixing things. I've loved fixing things since I was a little kid. Since I was, you know, I remember finding in a garbage a little pinball game, and I brought it home and it didn't work. And so everybody else was like, oh, well, whatever. So they all went away. And I went and I spent hours working on this little pinball machine. And I couldn't have been more than 5, 6, 7 years old at the time. Do you remember this? Huh? And I got it to work. I got it to work. It was awesome. Well, yesterday, I was taking some electronics to the recycle center here in Twin Lakes. There's where you recycle your leaves. You can't throw your electronics anyway. Throw your electronics away anymore, right? It's against the law. You could be penalized, you know, something. So I was taking some sundry electronics that I always forget on the day when it's there and it's open. It's only open on Wednesday, Saturdays, and Sundays. So I remembered on the day it was open. It was awesome, right? So I threw the stuff in the truck and went to the recycling place. And so I'm pulling up, back up, and throw the stuff. And there is a box in the electronics recycling bin that says 40-inch Samsung flat screen TV. And I thought, what?
A challenge.
I'm a dumpster diver, okay? I threw my stuff away, and then I didn't know what. I looked in the box, and you know, the first question I had is the screen broken? Because if the screen is broken, it's like a CD player. CD players, when they stop working, are done. Okay, this is just from a perspective of a fixer. It's hopeless. It's not like the VCRs of old, you know, where you could actually fix a VCR, but you can't fix a CD player once it's broken. So I looked in, and sure enough, the screen was not broken. So I grabbed that box, and I threw it in my car, and I brought it home. And Susie's like, what are you doing? I said, I found this TV in the recycle bin, and I want to see if I can fix it. It's too big. She's obviously a woman, right? No man in his right mind would say a TV's too big. So the long and short of it is that I fixed it. It was broken. And I fixed it. Thank God. So now I have a 42-inch flat screen TV in my bedroom.
Where does Susie sleep?
But I love fixing things. Well, we're talking this over the last few weeks about Jesus' love and the importance of Jesus' love to us in loving like he does. You know, we... okay. I've got my tablet and I wasn't prepared, so now I'm there. All right. Jesus, when... We talk about love in the church. You know, there are churches that say we need to love God with all our heart, soul, and mind, and strength, right? We don't say that here. No, I'm just kidding. We do. We say that. And then they say we need to love our neighbors as ourselves, and that's awesome, too. We do that here, too, right? But then we talked about last week how Jesus said, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you. By this all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." So we take that as seriously as the first two, which is to love God and love our neighbor. We also love our brother. We want to love our brother like Christ loved the church. And so last week we talked about how Christ loved us by laying down his life for us, and how we need to love each other by laying down our lives for each other. And one of the things Susie mentioned that obviously stuck out to her was the need for us to bear our one another's burdens. Laying down our lives for each other means we bear one another's burdens. At the same time, I like the other side of that, which is loving one another means that we carry our own load. We bear one another's burdens in those times when we can't deal with our life problems. But on the flip side of that, we're not constantly looking for everybody else to help us live our life, deal with our problems. We're becoming healthy enough that we can live on our own for most of it, and then when we need the help, we can get it. Well, Christ loved us in three different ways, and we're going to look at the second way this week, and I don't know that we're going to make it all the way through the sermon, but that's okay, because we'll continue on after we come back from our other retreat. The new commandment to love one another, two. This is two here, okay? Christ showed us how to love the church. Okay, you know Christ loved you by laying down your life for you, right? His life for you. But he also loves the church. Look at Ephesians chapter 5, verses 25 through 27, and then 29 through 30. Now, if you have the YouVersion app on your iPhone or phone or whatever, you can go under the menu and go to Live and search for this location, and the notes are there if you want to do that. But we're going to look here at Ephesians 25 through 27 and 29 through 30, where it talks about Christ loving the church. Husbands, love your wives. We could just end there and go home, right?
Amen.
Just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of the water by the word, that he might present her to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish, for no one ever yet hated his own flesh. I'm sorry, I'm throwing the King James in there. That's what I memorized this in as a child. But nourishes and cherishes it even as the Lord does the church, for we are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones. Okay, so Jesus does two basic things for the church. First of all, he sanctifies and cleanses her, right? That's his goal, is to sanctify and cleanse the church, to make us as people, as his church. The church is people, it's not a building. Sanctified and cleansed, present ourselves a glorious church without spot or wrinkle. He doesn't want us to be a wrinkly church. He wants us to be without spot and without wrinkles. For some of us, that's too late, me particularly. And then he nourishes the church and cherishes the church, as we do our own body. So Christ loved the church by giving himself for her. And the church is always referred to as a her because it's the bride of Christ. So even though we're masculine men, we're still a part of the her of the church. Are you okay with that, guys?
Mm-hmm.
There's a book about the feminizing of the church. Okay. All right, anyway. So we have an opportunity to give ourselves for the church. Then if we're going to love like Christ loved us, then we're going to give ourselves for the church. Ephesians 4:15 through 16 kind of explains how that happens. It says, "But speaking the truth in love, you and I, as Christians, as a part of the church, may grow up in all things into him who is the head of the church, which is Christ, from whom the whole body, all of us together, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effect of working by which every part does its share, causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself." So Jesus Christ sanctifies and cleanses the church and nourishes the church. For you and I, we sanctify and cleanse each other by being joined and knit together. Being joined and knit together is how we can sanctify, help Christ sanctify and cleanse the church. Can you make that connection? I'll explain it to you as we go if you don't. And then each part, doing its share, is what nourishes the church. So Christ gave himself for the church so he could cleanse her and nourish her. And we can love like Christ and give ourselves to the church by staying joined and knit together and doing our share in the church. So the question I have this morning is, do you love the church? Do you love the church? You know, the church is one of the worst places to be sometimes, isn't it? I've been fired as a pastor. I've been forced to resign as a pastor. I've been forced out because I people didn't want to do the things that I wanted to do in the church. But it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter because I love the church. You know, I love science fiction. I love fixing things. And of course, I love my family. But I also love the church. There is something about the church, the body of Christ, that makes whatever, I can't think of a pleasant word to use that is appropriate to use in mixed company with little kids, if there are any in here. Whatever garbage happens in the church, to me, is worth living through because the church is the body of Christ.
Amen.
And I need to love the church. Okay, so number two in the outline. Number one, it said Christ showed us how to love the church. Number two, we need to give ourselves to the church by being joined and knit together. How do we become joined and knit together as a group of people? I mean, if you watch Cheers, it's all about, for those of you who are older than, you know. Do you watch Cheers? Yeah, okay. You know, it's insulting each other. It's making fun of each other. It's laughing at each other. It's living life together. What does it look like in it? That's what it looks like in the bar. What does it look like in the church? Well, there are things we need to do. If you look at 1 Peter 1:22, that we need to do to stay connected, to be knit and joined together. And that is, let me read it, 1 Peter 1:22. Since you have purified your souls in obeying the truth, since you are saved through the Spirit in sincere love of the brethren, love one another fervently and with a pure heart. Fervently, that you care about your faith, you care about your Christianity, you care about becoming the person God wants you to be. And then pure, you're going to do the work to deal with your sin. We all have sin. We have sin that we struggle with each and every day. And so in order for me to be a part of a knit-together body, a joined and knit-together body, I have to be fervent about my Christianity. I have to be willing to work at it. And not just coast, sit in the pew, and do nothing. And then I have to behave a certain way. It says in Romans 12, 9 through 16, let love be without hypocrisy. And one of the biggest complaints that people have as Christians against Christian is being a hypocrite. Now, what is a hypocrite? A hypocrite is someone who says one thing and does another. Is a Christian who sins a hypocrite? Only if they say they don't sin. We all sin. And just because I sin and sometimes do things that I say I shouldn't do doesn't make me a hypocrite. Hypocrite means I live one way in at work and another way when I come to church. That's a hypocrite. So we need to live without hypocrisy. Love, let our love be without hypocrisy. Abhor what is evil. Cling to what is good. We need to be kindly affectionate to one another in brotherly love. And so Paul gives us, explains how we do that. How do we show kind affection? How do you show affection? For me, I'm not really a touchy-feely kind of guy, necessarily. Sometimes I am. I mean, I get squeamish when girls touch me. Even at 50 years old, it makes me nervous when a girl touches me. But I like to help people. I like to serve people. And that's one, you know, you talk about your love languages, five love languages. Mine is acts of service. And being with somebody and spending quality time with them. You might think it's weird that the pastor's handing out bulletins in the entryway as you come in the church. I mean, most churches the pastor doesn't hand out bulletins in the entry. Why do I do that? I do it because I like it. I do it because I like saying hi to people. I like engaging people and talking to them. And believe it or not, this is not talking. We're not talking. I'm talking to you, and you're hopefully listening. But for some people, it's the only time I get to say hi to them when they come in the church in the morning. So we need to be kindly affectionate by giving preference to one another. Okay, how do we do that? In honor, giving preference to one another, not lacking in diligence, okay? Oh, my goodness. There was a prominent person in a group of Christians, all right? And this person was sitting down, and so he says to a person that is a part of the group that he's over, hey, go grab me a pop. He didn't say please. He said, go grab me a pop. Hey, you go grab me a pop. Is that giving preference? No, that's me expecting preference. I don't ask you, I don't even ask my wife or my kids to go get me a glass of pop or a pop. We need to, it says, not lagging in diligence. If I can do something for myself, I'm going to do it. And if I can do something for you, I'm going to do it. I'm going to be diligent. I'm going to be busy. I'm going to be active doing so. Okay, diligence. Fervent in spirit, caring about each other, caring about what's going on in each other's lives, serving the Lord, being active in the church. We are very active. We have a lot. If you're a regular attender, you probably have a job. I mean, that's just the way it is in our church. We're so small that we're serving the Lord together. Whatever way you're doing it, you're serving the Lord if you're an active part of our church. Rejoicing in hope. We're positive, you know. I tend to be a positive person. Sometimes I get in down moods, but I tend to be a positive person. But if you're a negative person, you need to really work on that and become more positive. I mean, not that you'll ever be totally, you know, not Pollyanna kind of positive, but coming in and being happy at church and, hey, how you doing? I'm glad to be here.
Oh, I wish I didn't have to be here today.
Patience and tribulation. You know, we all go through hard times. We do. Christmas and Thanksgiving are coming. And we're going to have to be around family we don't want to be with. And we have struggles in our lives. We have issues that come up. We have health issues, family issues, job issues. And it can be very discouraging. And sometimes that kind of thing makes people leave. It causes them to give up on their faith and walk away from Christianity. But if I'm going to be joined in it together, I have to be willing to stick those things out and stay with it. And even with things that are happening in the church, you know, church is I mean, I was meeting with Tom and Joan. I'm going to embarrass you guys. Tom and Joan this week. And talked about how when we have business meetings, what's the vote? What is the result of the vote? Can anybody tell me what the result of the vote is usually? It's almost always unanimous, okay? We work hard at creating consensus. But it wasn't always that way. When we started out, there was a lot of conflict early on when we started as a church. And there were people who bailed out because of that. And they're missing out on the unity that we have now as a group of Christians. So you got to be patient in tribulation and steadfast. Continue steadfast in prayer. We need to be a praying church, praying for each other, praying for the body, praying for outreach, praying for finances, praying for the roof to get replaced. Distributing to the needs of the saint. If you look at the bulletin, take out your bulletin, look at the budget. On the back page, variable expenses, kitchen supplies, ministries, Awana, look at benevolence. Last year we budgeted $200 for benevolence. But we gave out $1,744 in benevolence. That would be considered a a problem as far as a budget goes. So what did we do? We bumped up how much we figure we're going to spend on benevolence to $1,800. Because we need as a church to be willing to help each other financially when we're in need. So rather than say we're going to spend less money next year, we're saying we're going to spend more money this next year on helping people who are in need financially. Given to hospitality. Inviting people over to your house. You know, when I was starting out in ministry 22 years ago, in my first ministry, it was a church full of old people. I mean, everybody was over the age. I think the youngest person was 59 in that church. And she was the daughter of one of the elders. But everyone in that church expected a visit from the pastor at least once a year. Everyone. And so I had to keep track, I had to keep records of who I visited and when I visited and made sure that I get everybody visit. Now I can't get a visit to save my life. You know, there are people, I've never visited them because it's just not our culture to be, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. But in spite of the fact that our culture says we should not be welcoming people into our homes, what do we need to do to be joined and knit together? We need to be inviting people over. We need to be willing to open our doors. Amen. Let them into our house, into our home, into our world, so that we can be knit together and a part of each other's lives. So I'm free for dinner next Sunday. Actually, we should have it at our... No, I'm not going to do that tomorrow. Be a big fan. Blessing those who persecute you, bless and do not rejoice. Okay. I've experienced conflict in the church. Have you? And what I'm understanding this to say is that I'm doing whatever I have to resolve that conflict, to work through my conflict. Because it's we're people, and we have issues, and we do things. And I offend you, you offend me. Fortunately, we're healthy enough that we try to work through that. And if we're going to stay joined in it together, we have to. Because what happens? Negativity builds. It does. I've seen it over and over and over. People get angry and they get upset and then they leave. They're not willing to work through the conflict. I'm only going to get through the first point here, second point. And then to rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. And that's what we talked about last time, bearing one another's burdens, okay? Weeping with somebody who weeps. This isn't the suck it up church. At least we shouldn't be the suck it up church where you got a problem, suck it up. Walk it off. You know, a kid's got a broken leg with a bone sticking out. You walk it off. We need to rejoice with the people who rejoice and weep with the people who weep. We need to be connected with each other, talking with each other, living with each other, being a part of each other's lives so that we can be involved and happy when people... We should know the good things that are happening in each other's lives, and we should know about the bad things that are happening in each other's lives. That's being joined in it together. So we need to be giving preference to each other by doing these things, by doing what it takes to do these things. And then we need to have the same mind toward one another. Be of the same mind toward one another, verse 16. Do not set your mind on high things. High things. You ever have a soapbox? Do you have a soapbox? Mine soapbox is... That's my German heritage coming out. My soapbox is... carbon dioxide in the atmosphere and its effects on global warming. Okay, global warming is a huge issue, and I understand that there are complexities. I don't understand the complexities. I understand that there are complexities. But carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, the more carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, the worse the world is going to get. That's the theory. But do you know what carbon dioxide is? It's plant food.
All right. Plants should be better.
Right. So the assumption I make is that if there is an abundance of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, it's just plant food. And the plants, what do they need? They need water and sunlight and nutrients, and they get that from the soil. So all those things stay the same. What is plant waste?
Oxygen.
It's a win-win.
So the more carbon dioxide there is in the atmosphere, the more plant food there is. And so the more the plant food there is, the more plants will grow. The more plants grow, the more oxygen they'll produce. That's one of my soapboxes. It just doesn't make any sense to me. But we can get soapboxes in our churches. We were talking about, in the membership class, about the end times. You know, there are a lot of views about the rapture and when it's going to happen. There's the pre-tribulational rapture, pre-millennial pre-tribulational rapture. There is the pre-wrath pre-millennial rapture. There is a mid-trib pre-millennial rapture. There is a partial rapture pre-millennial rapture. There is the post-trib. I could go on and on and on, right? And sometimes those things can become really important, so much so that it divides the church, so that I am high-minded means that what I believe is more important than your well-being. And that's not the case, because in many ways, and many times, I'm wrong about what I believe. And so I should not be high-minded, set my mind on high things, think of myself as better, but associate with the humble. You know, I've had people say how the sermons that I preach are easy to understand. When I started out in the ministry, I didn't even understand what I was saying. My wife, it was horrible. She said it was horrible. It was horrible. I was so intellectual, so, you know, wanting to sound smart and be theologically astute. But you know what? If a fifth grader can't understand what I'm saying, then I am not doing what I should be doing as a pastor. I'm not preaching to the most intelligent person in here. I'm preaching to everyone. I want to preach to everyone so that everyone can understand. I use words everyone understands. I use concepts everyone understands because I want to associate with the humble. I want to be humble. So how else be humble than to associate with the humble, right? The lowly. Do not be wise in your own opinion. Don't think you know it all. Don't think that because you believe it, it's true. Don't think that I believe it because I believe it, it's true. I understand that there are differences of opinions. What I try to do is to gauge what I believe by how I understand the Bible, and the Bible's pretty clear. But when I think I know it all, I am not participating in being fit and joined together as a body. I'm not. I'm causing division in the church. God wants us to be knit and joined together as a church. So the question that I have for you is, this is the ending question, only the third through the sermon. It's okay, we got plenty of time. How have my choices affected how joined and knit together I am with the body of Christ? Because it's up to me, right? It's up to me about whether I'm knit and joined together. And a part of that knitting and joining, a part of that cleansing and purifying that it talks about in Ephesians chapter 5, sanctifying and cleansing. What have my choices done that have affected my ability to be those things, to love like Christ in the church? Now, I know that we have visitors here, and you might go to churches elsewhere. But we make decisions about participating, about being a part, hospitality, about, you know, being high-minded. All those things have an effect. And we need to, if we want to love like Christ, we need to be willing to do the things Christ wants us to do as Christians. So that's the first installment of this probably two-part message. And I want you to be praying about that as a Christian, as a part of the body of Christ. Are you loving the church like Christ loved the church? Let's pray. Lord, thank you for your love for us. Lord, and we thank you that you've given us the church, that it is the body of Christ. We thank you that you have, Christ, you have set yourself as the head of the church, and that we can find our way because you are in charge. Mm-hmm. You've given us these guidelines, these directions to follow, so that the church that you have made us a part of can be purified without spot or wrinkle or any such thing. Lord, we want to be a church that has less spots and less wrinkles. We want to be a church that honors you and loves like you. Mm-hmm. Lord, I pray that you would answer our prayer and that you would give us the strength to do these things. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, actually, Aaron has left. Aaron has left the building.
Uh-oh.
So we are not going to have a closing song, but we are going to stand together and pray. And then there's fellowship, food, in the back. And we would love to have you join us. And again, if you want to help with the fellowship, you can talk to Susie after the service. Lord, we are so grateful for the worship today, for the time to spend together. Lord, help us to cherish this time, be fervent in our desire to be a part, Lord, associating together. Lord, these things all make church a wonderful place to be, and we just pray that you would be with us now and help us to grow in this area. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.